Thanks so much, Carol, for the invitation to speak here in this distinguished lecture series. I've watched actually quite a few of the videos that you post online myself. So I like this resource, and I'm happy to contribute to the online library in this way. Thanks also for your very kind introduction. The topic I'm going to speak about today, transnational disobedience, might strike some of you at least as somewhat maybe counterintuitive, because often these two topics, migration and civil disobedience, are discussed separately. Obviously, both of them are very much on the political agenda today. And maybe that combination is also not as counterintuitive today as it might have seemed, you know, even a couple of months ago, whether you think of the so-called migrant caravan, which just reached the American border, led by thousands of American soldiers and armed police shooting tear gas at the migrants who, you know, tried to flee conditions that made life very difficult for them, which is just the most recent case in which this combination of migration and disobedience maybe comes together. Or earlier cases such as the sans-papiers in Paris, France, who in 1996 occupied a church in the center of Paris, which was then evacuated by the police, as it says here, avec humanité et cœur, so with, not sure how to translate that, but with a humanitarian and kind of friendly attitude. But that's obviously not how it was experienced by the migrants and refugees who were evacuated from that church. They constituted themselves as a political movement, claiming voice in the French public debate, claiming a political status that they didn't have, thus bringing together the topic of migration and the topic of disobedience to, you know, more local instantiations that are not as well known as, for example, this refugee movement in Amsterdam in the Netherlands, which has the very interesting title name, We Are Here. And, you know, simply this claim, We Are Here, stepping into the public's eye in this way, is already kind of an act of disobedience. They're not really breaking the law by claiming we are here, but they're disrupting established understandings of what is political, who counts as a political subject, etc. Maybe you've also come across this French farmer, Cédric Héroux. He was sentenced by a court in Nice for aiding migrants to irregularly cross the border from Italy into France and for hosting them. So there's a new category in France, which is called the crime of solidarity, as it were. People acting in solidarity with refugees, but being punished by the state for that. So these are just a couple of examples for motivating basically the question I want to ask today, namely whether it makes sense to bring migration and civil disobedience, these two discourses, together, and asking how far irregularized or irregular migration can be seen as a form of civil disobedience, one that is decidedly transnational. That's to a certain extent surprising, maybe, because if you know the discussion about civil disobedience, it's usually limited to the national framework. So civil disobedience seems to be a type of political engagement in which citizens appeal to other citizens. They make claims within a national public sphere, they appeal to the values that these citizens share, and they want to change certain laws and policies of whatever government they're living under. And I want to, the first part of the talk, just talk a bit about this, what I call the standard model of civil disobedience, which I think is very much wedded to what is sometimes called this methodological nationalism. So the idea that the nation state is somehow the natural unit for thinking about political action, political relations, etc., etc. Now, of course, political philosophy is not as much under the spell of that model as it used to be. You all know the debates, obviously, studying here, working here, on transnational, international issues in current political philosophy, But for a long time, of course, philosophy was very much characterized by this methodological nationalism. I think, in a way, the debate about civil disobedience is still suffering from what we call a hangover from this methodological nationalism. So we have all kinds of debates, including the one about civil disobedience, which are still prominently, and maybe not exclusively, but predominantly framed through that lens of the national frame. And I want to problematize that in the first step. In the second step, I'll say a bit about current normative debates on borders and migration, because if you want to talk about civil disobedience on the transnational level, the potential to do that in a way depends on asking whether, let's say, the framework within which it takes place is one that could at least potentially justify civil disobedience of that kind. And I want to show that the what we call the international border regime is indeed an adequate kind of object of civil disobedience, because it is in many ways problematic, normative, and also from a sociological, historical, legal perspective. And finally, and that would be the kind of main contribution I want to make with this talk, the paper, part of the book project that I'm trying to work on at the Institute of Princeton this year, I want to argue that it makes a lot of sense to think of greater migration in terms of transnational civil disobedience. All right, so a good place to start to see in a way how debate about civil disobedience is limited and does not even open up the conceptual space for thinking about migration and border crossing in terms of civil disobedience is what I call the standard model. I mean, of course, it's relatively much more complicated. There are quite a lot of different approaches, but I still think it's correct to say that at least until very recently, the view that John Rawls developed in the theory of justice, in the only part of that book which actually addresses what he calls non-ideal theory, section on civil disobedience, has become very influential, in a way dominating in the philosophical debate. It also captures quite well, I think, the consensus in the broader public, journalists, politicians, etc., insofar as they recognize that civil disobedience is sometimes called for. They come up with surprisingly similar definitions as the one that Rawls proposed. Jürgen Habermas is another influential author in this whole context, who, in his writings of the 1980s on that issue, follows Rawls very closely, maybe surprisingly closely if you know the rest of his theory. Essentially, what they agree on, and what is sort of the core of this kind of liberal standard model of civil disobedience, is that it involves citizens acting in public, non-violent, or justified in communicative ways. Okay, they break the law, but they do it in all these sort of morally significant ways, with the aim of changing certain aspects of the legal order, so not the legal order itself, but specific laws, for example, specific policy decisions of the government, while recognizing the general legitimacy of that order. And this expresses itself in different ways. The publicity condition is part of that recognition of the general legitimacy. Also, that you're supposed to accept the punishment and not evade state sanctions or legal sanctions is part of that expression of loyalty as it were to the existing system. So all of this sort of comes together in this definition that Rawls and others propose of civil disobedience. Now it's important that Rawls, I think, rightly says in his discussion that every theory of civil disobedience actually has to have three parts. It has to say something about the definition, what the concept actually encompasses, delineating it from other concepts, such as conscientious objection, but also more radical or violent forms of resistance. It has to say something about the justification of civil disobedience, under which conditions is it justifiable, and it has to say something about the role of civil disobedience in a given political order. So what is its role, what are the effects that we can expect from it. Now, I will primarily talk about the definition in this first part of the presentation, but I think that the liberal approach, what I could call the standard model, falls short in all three registries. So I think the definition, as I will try to substantiate in a moment, is much too restrictive and sort of normatively overburdened to really actually cover actually existing practices of civil disobedience, including the ones that Ross himself regards as paradigm cases, as it turns out. But also the justification, which in Ross's case is limited to his famous principles of justice, and actually especially to the first one, so to the principle of equal basic liberties, is limited. And I'll say a bit about why I think that is problematic. And finally, Ross and Habermas and others also subscribe to a very limited and essentially defensive understanding of the role of civil disobedience. They underestimate, I think, its potentially radical and transformative effects. Now, why is civil disobedience called civil in the first place by these approaches? The notion of civility is, of course, an extremely contested and also vague one. If you read anything about civility, you will very quickly maybe shocked or confused by the abundance of attempts to define what it is. It ranges from not being rude to being a citizen, from being kind of essentially bourgeois political subject to being nonviolent. I think in the discussion of civil disobedience, it has these different resonances with other key elements of the definition that I just alluded to. And they are all supposedly part of what it means for civil disobedience to be civil. So it has to be public. It should be nonviolent, which for Ross and Habermas, and also surprisingly, means that it should be exclusively symbolic. It should be communicative, not forcing your way onto others, but rather trying to convince them, loyal to the existing order, ready to accept the legal consequences. And it involves, and that's most important for my talk today, it's supposed to involve citizens appealing to other citizens within the constituted political community. Now, this is just, I'm not going to go through this, I just wanted to show you that I didn't make this list up, or this definition is really there in the text. I highlighted the elements that I just alluded to, and just from looking at it very quickly, you see that Ross and Habermas are in essential agreement of what the main constituents of the definition of that concept are. You can come back to that later if you want. What I'm now going to do is I'm just going to very quickly go through these different supposedly core features of civil disobedience and show why they are actually quite problematic. And I'm here building on recent discussions in which a wide variety of authors from Kimberly Brownlee, William Smith, Candice Delmas, and others who have recently picked up this debate on civil disobedience, which in a way died in the 80s after it was very much alive in the 60s and 70s. It has now come back in very interesting ways, in ways that are also much more responsive, I think, to current political developments, maybe not surprisingly given our political circumstances. And all of these elements have become problematized, I think, for very good reasons. I'm building on these discussions here. So first of all, the idea that civil disobedience has to be public. On the one hand, it's clear that it has to involve some kind of publicity, but it seems that both Rawls and Habermas and many others interpret publicity in a very narrow way. By Habermas, for example, thinks that it involves that it cannot be clandestine. He even thinks that you have to give the authorities fair notice in advance if you plan to engage in civil disobedience. If you have ever, even at a distance, sort of participated in an act of civil disobedience, we know that this would not work at all. If you announce that you will block the intersection down here, it will just not happen because the police will prevent it from happening. If you announce to the, to the university president that you're going to occupy his or her office in order to protest against cuts or something like that, again, this will not. They will just shut down the elevator and block the staircase or whatever. They do here, that's what they would do in my university. So you can't satisfy in a way these criteria, this criterion of publicity, this narrow way. And then there are, I think, a lot of practices of disobedience, especially online, which I won't talk about today, but which is another part of my whole project, where there's in a way a structural anonymity. And if you don't want to exclude them, simply for conceptual reasons, I think we have to be at least skeptical of this narrow definition of what public means and sort of extend it or revise it. It's equally problematic to just assume, which many of the authors in this debate do, that the non-violent character of civil disobedience means that it has to be purely symbolic. Often this is assumed without further discussion of what violence actually is, and hence without problematizing which types of behavior non-violence actually excludes. So just to give you a sense of how complicated it is, according to the German Supreme Court, and I'm sure that Germany is not the only country which takes that view, it is an act of violent coercion to sit down on the street and to block traffic from circulating. Now, to his credit, Habermas problematized this understanding of violence very early on in the 80s in his article that I referred to earlier. But you know, without a more specific discussion of what nonviolence actually means and which types of behavior are classified as violent, you know, is the destruction of property violence? Is it violence to inconvenience people or to stop traffic for circulating? Is it violence to harm yourself? Is it an act of violence that is incompatible with the civility of civil disobedience to use, you know, mild forms of self-defense against police violence? These are all questions that you would have to ask if you want to say that civil disobedience has to be non-violent in order to be civil. Yet, usually that's not even a topic that comes up in these debates. And surely, most acts of civil disobedience are not purely symbolic. I mean, they are always also symbolic. It's an essentially symbolic form of political action, I would argue. But occupying a building or blocking an intersection is obviously more than symbolic. It also involves an element of what one could call disruption or confrontation that is, you know, quite material if you want to use a term that goes beyond the merely symbolic or the merely communicative. And I think that's quite important for most actually existing forms of civil disobedience. That's basically the same point, just pointing out that there are forms of direct action. Here, this is actually not an animal rights protest, but German farmers unleashing their goals to stop nuclear waste transportation through their farmland. Now, again, obviously this is an act of symbolic protest. They want these pictures to be taken, to circulate, for people to see how, you know, to what kind of length the state has to go to deal with nuclear energy and its waste. But they also simply want to raise the costs for this policy option. The cost of these police, of the police securing the transport for weeks and weeks is just like gigantic. And they want to raise the costs symbolically but also materially in a way that makes it impossible for the government to pursue this option. Again, I don't think that that makes it uncivil in any kind of problematic way. Is civil disobedience necessarily loyal to the existing order and the rule of law? Well, it very much depends on what you mean with that. Martin Luther King was always possible around the Habermas regarded as a paradigm example, obviously, of civil disobedience. Famously said, the thing to do is to get rid of the system. That doesn't sound very kind of local as a project. And that's true of many acts of civil disobedience, those, you know, in the context of the Occupy movement, many other movements that have quite radical aims. So what does that mean? You know, which order, what kind of the actually existing rule of law, the slightly more ideal version of the rule of law? These are all questions, again, that we have to ask. And similarly for the readiness to accept the consequences. This, I mean, there's a debate over whether whistleblowing is something that's supposed to be, etc. I don't want to go into that, but if you think that potentially it might be an act of civil disobedience, the fact that Snowden escaped and thereby evaded the consequences itself doesn't seem to disqualify him from, this might be from that label, from that claim to civility. He certainly faced consequences. I mean, his life isn't the same. He lost his earlier life, right? He had to give it up and was in exile. That's a pretty harsh consequence. So we can be sure that he was relatively serious about what he was doing, right? Because often people say, well, if they evade the consequences, maybe they just did it for fun or for their own gain. And you know, there are other ways to test the authenticity of the principal motivation behind civil disobedience than putting people to court and to jail. But you know, more importantly, it's clearly not the case, I think, that civil disobedience is limited to those who are recognized as citizens in a brief community appealing to other citizens. There are a lot of examples, some of which I've alluded to at the beginning, in which non-citizens engage in forms of violating the law that fulfill many of the criteria of civil disobedience, and that I think at least we shouldn't exclude from that category by just stipulating the test of citizens. The claim I want to advance today is that it is, if you have a narrow understanding of citizenship as being the formal legal state of the state assigned to its subjects, it's completely irrelevant to the question of citizenship. If you have a case of civil disobedience, whether it's a citizen or not, this should be irrelevant to both the definition or the classification of that action and to the justification. And there are other things that are relevant about that. And I'll say something later about maybe the implications for turn to a broader understanding of citizenship that might follow from this. Here, in case you can locate that picture, it's refugees and migrants, the so-called summer of migration in Europe in 2015, who basically forced the Austrian and German government to open their borders by embarking on this march from Budapest to the border in large numbers. And very clearly they, you know, they combined this with a kind of moral political appeal in addition to just wanting to reach a better place for themselves. So if you take all these different problems with the standard definition together, I think we have very strong reasons to come up with an alternative understanding of civil disobedience that in my view should be less restricted, that should be less normatively loaded, and that in a way should just be broader to encompass the myriad ways in which people engage in civil disobedience in the actually existing political and social struggles that are happening around us. And I think from the very beginning, I mean, Rawls responded to a particular historical constellation. Habermas wrote his article in a particular historical constellation, responding to things that were happening on the ground. This is not a debate that happens in a kind of vacuum, but we try to theorize something that's actually happening. And for that reason, I think philosophers and theorists should pay much more attention to how the practice of civil disobedience has evolved. Of course, it doesn't mean that you just sort of blindly follow the practice by saying, well, whatever the agents themselves call civil disobedience, we should also call it that. There's still a kind of critical role for the theorists today, but I think primarily you should also learn from political practices and the ways in which agents interpret it, especially the kind of civil disobedience I think philosophers still have got to learn. Now, my proposal in light of these problems would be to reconceptualize civil disobedience in a somewhat different way, but still, you know, there's a lot of continuity, obviously, with the kind of standard model. As an intentionally unlawful and principal act of protest, this distinguishes it from neo-criminality or unmotivated rioting, if there's such a thing, with which political agents pursue the aim of changing laws, policies, or institutions in ways that are self-limited and can with good reason be seen as civil as opposed to military, sort of aimed at destroying or excluding people in the community. So that means it's much more minimalist, this definition of this proposal to reframe what civil disobedience is, whether it's public, whether it's nonviolent in the strict sense, whether it's only directed at state institutions or maybe also at other entities, corporations, transnational institutions, etc. Whether it's really so limited in its goals, restricted to transforming the system within its existing limits, etc. These are all questions that are, in my view, not part of the definition, although they might play a role in the justification. So maybe it's, you know, maybe if an act of civil disobedience is nonviolent, it's easier to justify it or other things being equal than if some form of violence is involved. But that's not the question. I don't think that we can just sort of solve this issue by resorting to a definition. Now, some people worry that going in this way, extending the concept to cover new forms of civil disobedience risks running into the problem of conceptual overstretch. So anything that suddenly comes to civil disobedience is the worry. Bill Scheuermann is the most prominent recent author in this debate who is worried about this and therefore argues that we have to stick with certain core elements of the liberal standard definitions, such as the respect for the rule of law, the publicity requirement, etc. But I would argue that this definition still gives you criteria to distinguish civil disobedience from other forms of political or non-political action. So it's not arbitrary. There's also some normativity in here, obviously. It's not arbitrary, but I think it takes better account of new practices and the challenges that they involve. I also have a view on the other two elements of the theory of civil disobedience that were all identified as a threshold of justification, whereas I prefer to frame it on legitimacy, because I think justification is not in a way the business of the philosopher. That's up for public debate. But maybe as philosophers we can do is to say something about the general legitimacy of this type of political action and about the role of civil disobedience. So I think, I'm basically a pluralist about justification. I think Gauss is perfectly right in saying that the violation of basic rights is a very prominent justification of civil disobedience, but I think it's wrong to think that this is the only, maybe the primary form of justification. Peter Singer very early pointed out that on Rawls's account, animal rights, civil disobedience can never justify it. So it just doesn't fall into the realm of justice as Rawls understands it. Others have pointed out that it's quite difficult to, on Rawls's account, justify civil disobedience on specifically democratic grounds. Ronald Dworkin famously argued in the 80s that governments that are democratically elected can simply decide whether to have nuclear energy, whether to engage in war, etc. And if citizens protest against that using civil disobedience, they are overstepping the line. Because that's a policy dispute, but it's not a matter of principle. The civil rights movement was a matter of principle, basic rights were at stake. So clearly for Dworkin, as for Habermas and Rawls, it was a justified form of civil disobedience. But Dworkin was very skeptical whether you could extend that to what he saw as mere policy disagreements. Now, I think he was also empirically wrong about saying that nuclear energy is a mere policy disagreement or going to war. But it was very difficult to say what might be the democratic claim of protesters against such governments. The same question came up during the whole protest against the American war in Iraq. The UK and the US, so the protests were partly claiming democratic grounds for this, were of course dismissed by many people as being against democratic governments were perfectly active in the realm in which they allowed them to act. All right, this again I will actually skip over and can talk about it later if you're interested in it, because it's not the core that I want to do here today. Okay, come back to that. Later as well. Now I think that this, let's say, revised model or understanding of civil disobedience is actually also better able to respond to three more general tendencies that I think characterize the practice of civil disobedience. So the first one I just talked about a bit, what I call here the democratization of disobedience, namely that it more and more is used as a way to respond to democratic practices rather than to invoke basic rights against overreaching democratic majorities. It's also increasingly transnational, that's what I'm going to talk about, today primarily. So you have transnational actors responding to transnational problems within a transnational public sphere, or at least a transnational political arena. And as I mentioned before, another phenomenon that interests me is civil disobedience that takes place either on the internet or by means of tools that are essentially digital. Now, today I'm going to talk, as I said, about the issue of transnational disobedience. And I want to single out the question whether sometimes, at least, not always, of course, irregular migration or irregularized migration. You can say something later about why I want to make the distinction maybe. Irregular border crossing is sometimes a form of civil disobedience. Now, I think in order to make that claim, to argue that it is at least a candidate for civil disobedience, we need to say something about the background conditions under which it takes place, because if, as many people think, it's simply the state's prerogative to regulate access to its territory, then it's very hard to see how migrants could justifiably or legitimately violate that claim of the state to regulate access by just border controls and engage in a kind of justified form of civil disobedience by migrating irregularly, crossing the border irregularly. So I'm going to keep this brief and probably not go into this at all. So just make a positive case for why I think the existing border regime is actually far from legitimate, and why the often assumed right of states to unilaterally regulate access to the territory and to their citizenship regimes, why that claim actually stands on very weak normative foundations. Now there's an interesting difference in the way in which so in the public debates, politicians, the media, etc., it's usually taken for granted that states do have this right. I mean, Trump is only the most recent and most extreme maybe articulation of this quite widespread consensus. So the idea is, it's just part of the sovereignty of the state, it's part of the democratic sovereignty of the people in that state to decide who to let in and not to let in. Maybe there are some exceptions there to make the refugees, but even that is not necessarily part of the consensus anymore. In the philosophical debate in recent years, this has actually come under attack from a whole variety of direction. I'm going to summarize in very brief form an extremely complex debate by basically saying that there are three reasons for doubting that states have such an unconditional right to regulate access. And that's then important for saying why irregular migration might be legitimate. So the first argument is an argument from justice or from distributive justice, which has been more prominently made by Joseph Kerens, but also by others, such as Alan Shafar. They basically claim that it's, from a moral perspective, from a humanitarian perspective, irrelevant where one has been born, yet the place of one's birth still is actually the most important factor that shapes your life prospects. Kerens speaks of an analog to feudal privilege here, so just as in the Middle Ages, the social location into which you were born was morally irrelevant but shaped all of your life prospects, the same holds for geographic location of birth today. Shakar speaks of birthright lottery. This is a somewhat problematic metaphor, I think, because it assumes that somehow there are these subjects floating around and then they are born in this lottery assigned to a certain geographical destination and then come into being as little babies. But I think it still makes clear what the problem is. That's one thing. Another thing is that citizenship regimes also serve to uphold global inequalities and to sort of immunize them from change. That's problematic for all kinds of reasons, but it's also problematic because of the historical genesis of most borders, which are, in the case of the US maybe most obviously, but in most other cases in Europe, for example, in Africa, etc. as well, very much intertwined with historical injustices, the effects of colonialism that have lasting impact until today. So simply from a perspective of justice, it seems problematic to assume that borders are just there and states just have the right to regulate process them. There's also an argument for freedom, more specifically freedom of movement. Again, Kerens is maybe the most prominent proponent of this argument. Within states, it's completely undisputed that freedom of movement is one of the basic, actually human rights, and not only citizen rights. It's also part of a global mobility regime in which most of us probably participate. So I'm lucky enough to have a German passport, which is ranked together with Singapore as number one in the global passport ranking, so I can access most countries in the world without a visa or with a visa on arrival. But if you're a citizen of Afghanistan, which is I think the lowest ranking country, it's quite limited, the number of countries to which you can travel without going through a lot of hassle or actually all having any possibility of going there. So why might that be problematic? Clarence basically argues that the same normative considerations that speak in favor of a right to freedom of movement within states, within Afghanistan, within Germany, etc., actually also speak for a right of international freedom. Yeah, whether you speak in terms of, again, justice requirements or the fact that people should be able to find occupations, friends, families, etc. And these are all normatively significant considerations. And finally, there's an argument from democratic legitimacy, which has been proposed by Bunche, who argues that as all state authority that involves coercion and requires democratic legitimation and not just moral justification, the fact that borders are backed up by coercive measures by the state triggers, as it were, a requirement of democratic legitimation involving those who are directly subjected to that threat of coercion, so migrants or potential migrants. It gives rise to a political, not just to a moral claim, so it's not just that you have to somehow justify it to them in a kind of hypothetical discourse, but he thinks that there are actually democratic entitlements of participation that result from it. Now obviously it's not so easy to imagine how this might actually be operationalized, but I think it's an interesting thought, and it certainly problematizes the simple assumption that somehow democracy just unproblematically requires borders, and that there's a simple democratic justification for borders. Now, if you take all these normative counter-arguments together, even if you're skeptical about each of them individually, I think together they have quite a significant normative force, and they actually come, they actually contribute to what I call over-determined illegitimacy of the international border regime. So not only do you have what's normative reasons for being skeptical about that regime, it's injustice generating and preserving, it's freedom restricting, and it's very much undemocratic. You also have legal reasons for doubting its legitimacy. In the EU, for example, it's actually, according to most legal experts, very clear that, for example, the EU-Turkey deal is against international law. It violates obligations of EU member states that they have under international law. That's a pretty big problem. I'm sure that similar things hold for Trump's decision to not let people apply for asylum at the US border, but rather to handle this on the Mexican side. There are humanitarian reasons for the illegitimacy of the border regime. Alone, only in 2018, 2,119 people have died in the Mediterranean trying to cross the Mediterranean usually from the North African shore. That's as of today, so there's NGOs monitoring these deaths. Obviously on a global scale it's much more, although the Mediterranean turns out to be the most deadly water space at the moment. Just by comparison, at the US-Mexican border, I think it's around 350 people who died this year. Still quite a significant number, one would think. So there's that problem as well. And finally, there's the historical problem I already alluded to, namely that the legitimacy of borders as they actually exist is in doubt because of the historical genesis. Now, if all of this is partly only convincing, then I think there's a very strong preliminary case, at least, to think that irregular border crossing, crossing the border without proper authorization, without going through the proper procedures, is a legitimate form of protest against that regime. It's both the outcome of that regime and the protest against it. That's what I want to at least quickly do in the third step in the remaining couple of minutes. So my point would be that against this background that I just sketched, irregular or unauthorized migration can indeed be productively seen as a form of transnational civil disobedience. I think it helps to look at irregular migration through the lens of civil disobedience, and the same goes the other way around. So it also helps to think about civil disobedience if we take that as a starting point for our case. One reason to think of it as civil disobedience is that it highlights, I think, much more the political agency of migrants as political subjects, because they are largely absent in philosophical people. If you read Terence and all these other authors whose arguments I find very convincing, actually it's just migrants and their own claims or their own agency play usually no role at all. Sometimes they come up as examples, sort of giving some substance to the abstract claims, but they don't really play such a big role as agents themselves. And I think that would be one way to remedy this, I think, deficit. Now, in terms of the other way around, what can we learn about civil disobedience by looking at transnational migration? I think we can see that the agents, the practices, and the aims of civil disobedience can be reconceptualized along the lines that I sketched in the first part of the presentation. So I want to talk about all three aspects just very quickly. So just to remind you, the classical liberal definition, civil disobedience involves citizens acting in public, et cetera, ways to pursue sort of local changes in the laws and policies of a political community. So first of all, how far does taking transnational migration seriously as civil disobedience challenge the account of agency? Just, it's sort of obvious given what I said before that the agents and the addressees can no longer be understood as citizens belonging to one political community and appealing to each other. As I said, even in the national case, it actually seems irrelevant that people are formally recognized citizens. Other factors play a much more important role. And at the same time, I think it provides us with strong reasons to move away from this kind of formalist, status-oriented understanding of citizenship and understand citizenship much more as something that is also enacted or performed, that is a practice, and that people can engage in even without being formally recognized as citizens. And it's quite interesting, I think, that many excluded populations have become citizens by acting as if they already were citizens. So occupying women when they were excluded from citizenship, workers when they were excluded from citizenship, migrants when they are still now today excluded from citizenship, often make claims to citizenship by acting as if they already have the right to speak, to participate, etc., which they often don't. Now what is quite interesting of these more recent developments in terms of migrant activism is that, in contrast to the sans-papiers, also to the refugee group I mentioned that is active in Amsterdam, these are all cases of, as it were, post-migration activism. So people migrated, they have been in Paris, in the Netherlands for many years, working, being precarious, undocumented, etc. And then they start claiming political status, a voice in the debates about them, some kind of basic security and rights, etc. Now that's important, it has been written about, and it's philosophically significant. But what I think is quite interesting in the more recent cases, so the European summer of migration that I mentioned, but also the migrant caravan, is that the act of crossing the border itself becomes an act of civil disobedience. So the subject, migrant refugee that crosses the border, and not only the subject that has already crossed the border and now claims some kind of membership, is a new agent of civil disobedience. And there are many examples for this in the zone around Calais. I already showed this picture of the march of the refugees from Budapest to the German Austrian border. These are some of the examples that might have carried in probably as well. It's also showing us that there are new practices of civil disobedience that do not fit some of the traditional ways of conceptualizing it. So clearly, it's not only an appeal and it's not merely symbolic what is going on. I mean, even those who are open to you know, saying that migrants, refugees, under some circumstances are justified in crossing the border. They don't want to speak of civil disobedience because they say, but they simply in a way take what they have a right to. It's like acting under the right of necessity or something. So no one should blame them. We should maybe even grant them you know, amnesty, etc. But why call it civil disobedience? Well, I think that we shouldn't be too quick here, because it's true that on the one hand it is a form of direct action. You do violate the law, and that is not merely symbolic. You know, it doesn't stand for something else. They just want to cross that border. That's what they do. But at the same time, it has become coupled with political claim making in a way that goes beyond this form of direct action and just sort of taking what you think you have a right to. So it's not just about invading borders, it's also about protesting them on a symbolic level, very much in public, but as I said, not only on a symbolic level. And I think it also makes sense to call it civil, because it appeals to a different kind of civil bond. Of course, they are not citizens of the same political community, but they claim, in the French context, for example, to be the forgotten or repressed subject of an empire, for example. In many countries today, you have migrant, refugee, sort of chains of migration, which actually follow in reverse order, as it were, the vectors of colonization. And in the case of migration from South America and Mexico, Honduras, etc., as we get to the migrant caravan, of course, people argue that there is a bond that ties America, the US, to these countries, both in terms of economic forms of exploitation, military invasions, etc. So it's not as if we sort of are suddenly encountered with these migrants, encountering these migrants coming out of nowhere, as it is often portrayed in public discussions by politicians and media, etc. There is a link, and this link is also pointed out in much of this activism. So this, you know, there's just some examples for showing that the claim making is part of the migration itself, part of the crossing of the border. Lastly, and I'm almost done, 4 minutes today, I think you can also see that taking the aims of these transnational forms of disobedience seriously shows that it's not only local changes of laws or government policies that are at stake here, insofar as we take, you know, some of these articulations of aims seriously. These are quite fundamental issues. And they don't only involve you know, humanitarian, so we are victims, we have to help them, or self-interested aims. So Theresa May's famous quip about people jumping the queue. There are different ways of framing what is going on here that are very problematic. I think it makes sense to read at least some forms of irregular migration as form of protest against the global border regime, along the lines that the normative debate in political philosophy has also indicated. I think it also makes sense to see a new form of civil disobedience emerging here that is not, as Leslie Green has argued, merely corrective of or remedial. So it's not only saying we have a social contract in the political community, except it has been breached by the government, now we want to reinstate it. It's more radical, I think, than what you could call constructive or constituent form of civil disobedience, in which the claim is that there has been no legitimate way of organizing the global border regime up until today. So it is a task to engage in that. I think it's also worth pointing out that transnational disobedience has an important epistemic role to play, showing that there are these historical connections and continuities, problematizing what Luis Cabrera has called the averted gaze. It's understandable that people don't want to be confronted with the way in which they implicate a lot of the problems that make people migrate and how their own country might be involved in larger historical long delay forms of bordering that are problematic. We like this quote of, in response to the anti-immigrant rhetoric of some US politicians pointing out that maybe the colonization of North America was the biggest legal immigration that actually happens in the history of humanity, or at least the history of humanity is full of irregular immigration in that sense. So I think what is basically my main claim here is to argue that transnational civil disobedience is relevant because it politicizes and brings into the public debate something that is often at least taken for granted, namely that states have borders, that states have unilateral rights to regulate these borders, and that these borders are simply necessary for political, economic, social, cultural, etc. reasons. I think in that sense, a lot of recent migrant protests at the border is a kind of practical complement to some of the quite abstract, normative, philosophical problematizing of the border that I've talked about in the second section. Thanks for your patience. I'm looking forward to that.
Seems like all the examples you use are of like migrant, actual migrant protests. But then it seems like maybe you want to use the category of civil disobedience to cover a much larger category of irregular migration. And I just wonder if that's the work it's supposed to do or not. I mean, it does seem like the vast majority of people who cross borders are probably just interested in either a better life or fleeing something really bad. And have no, and are not in principle oriented toward, you know, objecting or rejecting any principles at all. So I just wondered if it was supposed to cover those people, whether those are their intentions or not. And then one other little question. I think in the US context, people on the left, or sort of a progressive rhetoric, is don't call these people illegal immigrants or anything like, don't use the term illegal, but if you talk about civil disobedience as intentionally illegal, you just categorize all these people as, you know, intentionally doing something illegal, so it brings with it the baggage of that political rhetoric. Or I wonder if it does, or how you avoid that.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Jeff. yeah, good questions. I mean, so I'm still not entirely sure about how strong or how widely in scope I want the claim to be. I mean, what I'm pretty sure about is that actually in recent years it's a quite significant amount of migration that has taken this overtly political form, and that at least for these cases, which have been, you know, sort of quite spectacular and in the public eye without being understood in this particular political way, and certainly it makes a lot of sense to think of them as forms of transnational civil disobedience. And that would already be something, I would say, because it already would be enough to sort of problematize a lot of the assumptions that I find unconvincing in the what I call the standard model. But I do think that potentially this could expand to more cases of irregular migration. For a variety of reasons. So even if they do not take such an overtly political form where, you know, migrants cross the border holding statements in their hand, I mean, that these were some of the examples that we've seen in recent years now with the caravan and the so-called long summer of migration in Europe a couple of years ago. So these are the clear cases. But also in other cases where migrants don't cross the border in that kind of visible way, but, you know, which is very understandable, try to avoid the public gaze because they know that otherwise they might not be able to do it. I don't think that we should exclude the possibility that there is actually whether a clear intention or a rather diffuse consciousness of the political significance of what they are doing. So I doubt actually that there's that much empirical certainty to what you said. Maybe that surely they don't have any objection to the principles underlying the current border regime. I think there is a relevant sociological and ecological research that suggests otherwise. And there the, let's say, practices of solidarity that you find in migrant communities, which often involve enabling the regular crossing of borders, are one element that one, you know, could see as an empirical indication that this is the case. Yet, you know, I don't want to claim that all cases are ipso facto forms of civil disobedience. That would surely be too strong. So clearly there are some cases where it's simply not the case that they are in any way connected with some kind of political awareness or consciousness or intentionality. There's a debate between William Smith and Luis Cabrera on this point in contemporary political theory, where Smith basically says, no, the clear intention has to be there, because that's what we know from standard case of civil disobedience. It's just not there in the case of violence. I already said why I find that empirically at least questionable. And Cabrera says intentions don't matter at all, and what matters is the objective significance of what is happening, which maybe goes too far in the other direction, and so I don't necessarily want to say that. Although I think he does have a point. I mean, also in a lot of cases of civil disobedience in the standard frame of the nation, you know, people have often mixed motivations, and it's very hard to know, often for the activists themselves, why they are doing what they are doing. Sometimes it's, you know, you go to a protest for entirely different reasons, because you want to hang out with cool kids, or you know, you're just bored or whatever, and then you become politicized in the protest. I don't want to sound too paternalistic or something like that, but I mean, you know, I've seen student protests erupt at my university, and it was very interesting to see how first year students transformed into something quite different in the process. So that would be at least part of an answer to that first part of the question. Now, with the second one, my approach would be to say, well, I'm totally against, you know, calling people illegal. I mean, you know, no one is illegal as a person, or just a category mistake to say illegal immigrants. I don't think it's so problematic to say that they, without being illegal themselves, engage in actions that are considered illegal. They know that. That's why they engage in them in certain ways, either covert or by public. It's also a form of, I know it doesn't work so well at the US border, but crossing the Mexican border, for example, it was a clear strategy of the caravan to say, this is a collective and very much in the public eye project, because that's the only way that you can actually avoid forms of violence that migrants are usually subjected to when they go. I mean, tens of thousands of people make precisely that trip that the caravan now makes every year. The caravan is also a way to make that trip in a collective and public visibly way, avoiding some of the other forms of violence that is being subjected to. Yeah, sorry. That's,
I just wondered if it was
on the
by the way, Luis Cabrera is going to be speaking here as part of our CJ series in the spring. So I'm not exactly on that topic. First, Josh, because he's asleep.
So I just wanted to circle back to the idea of the civil bond and you know, sort of dropping the citizen requirement. Maybe you answered this, but I didn't catch it. So the citizenship requirement that Habermas and Rawls assume does serve the purpose of, like, you just have this assumed idea that the oppression or the problem that you're dealing with is connected up to the people who are being disobedient in this very clear way because they're protesting the system that is oppressive. Is that a requirement on your view, that there is this historical bond? I mean, like, because it would seem to me like, on the one hand, that does make the account neat, and on the other hand, like, we don't want to just, or my impulse is that we don't want to just turn people away at borders because they don't have some particular clear historical connection to our particular historical oppression or something like that. And so I'm just wondering, like, what role of importance you think that other kind of civil bond you're emphasizing plays in the account?
Yeah, thanks. So, I mean, a lot more would have to, that was very telegraphic. So the idea there would be to say, a civil bond can take many forms. One is citizenship, another one is historical injustice or some kind of historical connectedness. These are two clear cases where a very strong form of obligation, I think, follows. So, you know, the UK or France cannot just say, well, who are these people? Why are they showing up? Why do they want to come here? I mean, there's a clear historical story that makes it necessary for them to take a very, you know, clear attitude and a very different one from the one that they take today. But I totally want to also at the same time not limited to these two, either citizenship or the historical injustice link. I think there can be quite a lot of functional equivalence, as it were, normative equivalence to these two, and the civil war can have different forms. So it could be economic interconnectedness. And that doesn't necessarily mean that the US government imposed structural adjustment programs on a series of Latin American nations, and that's why people now are coming here, etc. Or there's just a demand on the US labor market, which clearly makes it also hypercritical that now there's this idea of the wall, because the way you need this influx of undocumented migrants for that market to function, same as in Europe, care, agriculture, building sectors, which are not functional about irregular migration. So there's this link as well. And I think, you could even take, although then you would have to argue for that, and I did do that here, and I'm not sure I could, but you could, of course, have a kind of global interconnectedness claim that you find in the global justice literature, where the idea would be, there's no sort of critical threshold of global interconnectedness or cooperation has been reached, so that in some way there's a civil bond by definition. That would be maybe a rather thin one, but maybe it would be enough. I'm not sure about that, but I'm pretty sure about the other cases. But I would definitely want to say that there's a variety of ways in which that bond can manifest itself. And some of them provide stronger grounds, at least in the way in which I think about the knowledge of the numbers.
You try that for climate refugees too, in terms of
Thank you so much for your talk. I think I'm mostly convinced, but also my main question would be about the scope of your argument, and also in connection to the interventions. I was wondering, in your main definition, your alternative definition of civic disobedience, you say you contrast civil to military.
Yeah.
And I was wondering, because I think in most literature on democratic participation, civic is contrasted to the individual. So I was wondering whether the intentions of civic disobedience are in some way, whether an alternative would be individual being in some way or another, and whether the intention, the distinction between different kinds of intentions may have something to do with the distinction between civil and civic and the individual, more and civic and military or the state.
Yeah. Thanks. So just one quick terminological remark. I think I usually talk about civil disobedience, so it doesn't necessarily involve civic in the way in which it's sometimes used in the democratic literature. But on the other hand, there are actually some authors, Giotelli would be the most prominent one maybe, who say, well, forget about civil disobedience. We should talk about civic. And he doesn't even like the word disobedience for also interesting reasons. So civil, he thinks, is just too wedded to the kind of status conception of citizenship, so he wants to say civic. Disobedience, he thinks, is problematic because it's too reactive, too negativist in a way. So you disobey something which you in a way have to first accept. And he thinks a lot of the interesting forms of resistance in also this negative sense, so let's say doing things differently today, are actually of a different form. They just involve in a way ignoring the state and just doing. So for example, an interesting case, then I come back to the question. An interesting case is our First Nations, especially in North America, who reject the whole vocabulary of protest, disobedience, resistance, because they say, we're not interested in the state. We're not trying to persuade the state, pressure it on. We just want to do our own thing. And if the state has a problem with that, that's the state's problem, not ours. I mean, of course, it's also their problem because they go to jail, etc. But as a normative or political stance, I totally understand that. And I see that as a limitation of the whole civil disobedience frame, that it somehow puts the people who fall under it in this relation to the state. Okay, but put that to a side. Now, I understand the civil primarily in contrast to the military, simply because I want to have a quite broad understanding of the civil, so move away from the very normatively loaded understanding of it that we find in much of the literature. And for me, the core of the civil and civil disobedience consists in that you stand in a political relation to others with whom you engage. Now, a political relation can take a lot of different forms. It can be extremely confrontational. I think it can be violent to a certain degree, but it cannot be aimed at the destruction of the other, the physical or symbolic destruction, or exclusion from the community. That's why I think that certain forms of extreme right-wing protest or resistance cannot claim the label of civil disobedience, because they either aim at excluding people from the political community, or in many cases even physically mutilating them. So that's for me the core. It has to be political, but as I said, the political can take a lot of forms. Now I also usually think of it as collective, and in that sense it would sort of speak maybe to your concern to delineate the civil or the civic from, you know, individuals aiming at personal gain. I would also think that the principal character would exclude, you know, mere disobedience and certain personal gain. I mean, there might be cases of individual civil disobedience, but I think they're always somewhat better than the broader collective practice from which they get their meaning. A very interesting case, of course, is Henry David Thoreau, who's really credited with inventing the term, although he didn't use it. And the title of his essay was a different one when he wrote it, published it. Later, got the best-selling title, Civil Disobedience, that it has now. I don't know, did he get Civil Disobedience? I mean, first of all, he went to jail for one night. If you read the text, you think he was in jail for years. He says, I came out of jail a different man. The world wasn't the same. Yeah, he was there for 1 year, for one day, night, before his aunt bailed him out against his will. And he didn't talk about it for years, you know, that he did that, that he didn't pay the tax, out of protest against the American war, against Mexico, and against slavery. Yet he's one of the paradigm cases that we discussed. So, I don't know. But I think, in general, it should be collective, and in the standard cases, it is collective.
Just a quick question. Does your view include
the
indirect action?
So I think there are ways to delineate direct action from civil disobedience, and there are some cases of direct action which one involves civil disobedience and the other way around. But I think a lot of cases of civil disobedience actually do involve elements of direct action.
From your definition, it seems included.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I wouldn't want to say that it has to be there in all instances. So if that would follow from the definition, that might be...
Not that it's required, right then, just whether it's included.
It can definitely be included or covered, and I think that's necessary, because otherwise it would be very difficult to include, you know, standard cases of blocking intersections, occupying buildings, blocking deportation attempts by the state, etc. So these would fall out of the category if we say there's a strict distinction between these two. I mean, so another more general or methodological point would be to say that I think there are these different categories and they should be distinguished, but I think there's also a lot of gray areas between them. The same holds for civil disobedience and conscientious objection. It seems clear, you know, conscientious objection is when you just don't want to participate in something, but you don't aim at changing the law or how things are organized. That's civil disobedience. Well, conscientious objection happens to be legally, constitutionally protected in many countries, including Israel, for example. Now, there are soldiers in the Israeli Defense Forces who refuse to serve in the occupied territories, claiming the protection of the constitutional provision. And the Israeli Supreme Court, in a widely discussed case, said, you can't do that, because laws showed that there's a clear distinction between civil disobedience and guys fall on the civil disobedience side, so you have to go to jail. Which prompted a lot of famous legal philosophers, including Joseph Ross, David Enoch, etc., to write, you know, sorry, first of all, you probably got Rawls wrong, but also Rawls got it wrong. That's not how it works, but especially it cannot be the state who says where conscience begins or ends. You know, that's not, that cannot be the point of this. So I just want to say, of course, there are clear cases on both sides of the distinction, but there are also many cases where it's absolutely unclear and where it's politically and legally extremely difficult to figure out what the right way.
A lot more questions.
kind of wanted to go back, you answered this a little bit, but I wanted to go back to maybe using the framework of civil disobedience is somehow already too conservative to sort of characterize the political aspect of the regular migration that maybe we want to highlight. I mean, just looking at the second condition of how political agents need to pursue the aim of changing laws or something in a way that's somehow self-limiting, might make that already is insufficiently radical. Challenging like the very existence of borders, the very idea of unilateral control, is not self-limiting in that way. And so, in that sense, it goes something beyond civil disobedience. So even though you want to reconceptualize civil disobedience as less status, perhaps, it's maybe still operating some kind of conservative gap. I was wondering what you thought about that.
Yeah, thanks. So I think there's definitely a risk of civil disobedience being too conservative a framework. So, on the one hand, I think there are theoretical reasons for, extending the category and applying it to these cases. You know, having to do with the fact I think a lot of features of these cases actually, you know, fulfill a sensible definition of the term. There are also, of course, strategic or political reasons. Civil disobedience as a category just has kind of normative, symbolic appeal. It produces a sense of legitimacy that a lot of the other categories, resistance, protest, etc., do not necessarily have, partly because of the idea that history associated with it. So people have sort of romanticized notion of the civil rights movement, etc., and think that it's good things civil disobedience. So I think that's why there's really a struggle about this label, and activists try to apply to their own actions while the state usually tries to keep them from doing that successfully, because then it's easier to deal with them. So there are what are sociologically called boundary struggles about where the civil ends and where it begins. But more importantly, I wanted to say two things. So one is, in many circumstances, I think people would be justified in engaging in much more radical forms of resistance, but still they don't do it. And they can do it for a large variety of reasons. Some of them, again, pragmatic, some of them normative, political, etc. And I want to take seriously the fact that, not necessarily in the cases that we're talking about here today, so migrants crossing the borders, although some of them actually use that language as well, but of people in sort of non-democratic regimes, so you know, context I know, Turkey, Pakistan, China, for example, thinking of their own oppositional activity as civil disobedience, although Rawls and many others would say, don't bother with civil disobedience, you can go to full-scale militant uprising, essentially, because you're operating in a non-democratic, non-liberal regime. Well, why do you want to limit yourself in that way? But I think that these people have a very strong case to make why that label applies to what they are doing. And I think one should take that seriously. Now, does that mean that they pursue non-radical aims? No, I think they often aim at a quite radical transformation of the societies in question. I think the same is true for some civil disobedience movements in liberal societies, and the same is true for some of the migrant activism I've been talking about. So the self-limitation is not so much a self-limitation to local changes, but rather a self-limitation in the means that are employed. Now, traditionally, that's captured by the category of nonviolence. I think we can endorse it from the violence, but it still has to be self-limiting, self-reflexive in the way in which a lot of these movements are actually firmly engaged in reflecting on which means to be employed, which these means fit the ends that we pursue, the whole debate of prefiguration in the context of the occupied movement, other movements that I was playing, etc., sort of goes in that direction. So it's the means rather than the ends that the category of self-limitation applies to. And if that's the case, I think the risk of being insufficiently radical is at least somewhat different from maybe the one that we're talking
about. So, two quick questions on some conceptual issues, and it picks up on a couple of things that the people have mentioned. So first off, this distinction you're making between civil disobedience and military resistance. I think might be problematic because from the standpoint, especially of contemporary ethics warfare, notions of what military activity is broad, right, to include a lot of what you're describing. So whether it's lawfare activities or whether it's cyber attack or sabotage, or you know, armed movements for devolving to have localized autonomy, which is entirely political, as you were describing. So I'm not sure how you're going to parse that out clearly. And the second thing is, you know, one thing I'm always thrown off by people, you know, holding up walls is this model for talking about civil disobedience, is that he presupposes a society with a common sense of justice that people are appealing to, namely the two principles. Now, if you're talking about this transnational political order, there is no shared sense of justice. There are no underlying principles to appeal to. And maybe this is what you're pointing to late in your talk about a constructive model, trying to construct some image of justice in all of this. But it struck me that what we might be looking at is a situation more akin to what Roz describes as we have a right to disobey, similar or not, because we're confronting a transnational order that lacks justice, period.
Thanks. Yeah, these are two good questions as well. So first, I share your diagnosis. So there's definitely, let's say, a political push, sometimes also a legal push, to extend, let's say, militarized vocabulary to forms of political activism that have previously been distinguished from terrorism or military uprisings. You can only think of Trump's rhetoric of invasion when he talks about the migrant caravan, so as if it's basically an army coming to invade the US. This has a clear purpose, I would say, namely delegitimizing certain types of activity and making it easier and in the public eye more acceptable for the state to use forms of policing, legal, other forms of repression that might not be acceptable if one would describe what is going on as protest that is at least in principle legitimate. So there's a clear struggle about these labels. If you look at, you mentioned the whole debate about cyber terrorism, etc. I mean, if you look at digital forms of disobedience, it's actually very interesting that in contrast to how civil disobedience is now sometimes treated in courts, where judges say, well, we should take into account that these people have political motivations, they're not ordinary criminals, etc. This has been completely rolled back in the case of digital disobedience. So even if there's a clear political motivation and, you know, no private gain, no criminal intention, etc., that can be demonstrated, the sentencing is often very harsh. And I think it's partly because this is a new phenomenon, and there's also a worry that it could spread, and these are sentencings that have they have a lot of corporate power behind it. And they are supposed to deter people from engaging in this. And think of, you know, again, it's not, but the guy who downloaded the whole JSTOR archive at MIT and then was faced with a form of legal repercussion that was just unimaginable for suicide. Right? I mean, so this is the situation that we're in here. I think as philosophers, we shouldn't give in a way. I mean, you know, I'm prepared to argue with anyone who says, you know, these are forms of cyber terrorism, and, you know, try to show that that's an illegitimate extension of that category, which of course covers a lot of what is going on online, but not everything. You have to be able to make these distinctions if you are still committed to very, very basic principles of the rule of law, the democratic public sphere, etc. You cannot just criminalize dissent in these ways and it becomes so popular. Now, with regard to the other question that you had, appealing to a common sense of justice, well, so I think there are two things I want to say there. One is indeed the line that I take from Leslie Green, namely that there are these forms of civil disobedience which, in a way, point to the lack of a shared normative framework, a global sense of justice, etc. In a sense, similar things are true for domestic cases of civil disobedience. I mean, it's not so clear that King appears to a shared sense of justice. you know, he often talks as if he has to force white Americans to confront the issue that they just don't want to confront, which they don't feel by, driven by their sense of justice to confront. So he said, for example, you have to create a crisis that makes it impossible for white liberals to avoid the issue. And to always say, well, you know, you should keep calm, make, write another letter, then maybe you will come to a solution. So I think there are cases where you know, they go in the same direction. At the same time, I think what, you know, at least in these more recent cases has also happened is that you actually find, you know, I'm not sure that it comes out clearly in these, but in many cases they appeal to values and principles, you know, human rights, international contracts that states are subject to, etc., that are at least officially shared by US, Europe, etc. And they say, well, if you're really committed to these values and principles, then how is it possible that you deal with refugees and migrants in this way? So I think, to a certain extent, you could even see an appeal to the supposedly shared sense of justice that is failing here as well.
One more question.
Thanks so much for your talk. I guess I was a little bit curious about what is at stake in the question of whether some of these forms of transnational migration count as civil disobedience. Here's like an alternative way you could look at it. Well, we have like a wide variety of phenomenon of immigration non-compliance, and those phenomenon, the sort of fundamental question is, when are those practices justified? And calling one civil disobedience or not doesn't really add anything normatively to a description of the circumstances under which crossing the border without permission is justified. So I was curious how you were thinking about it. I mean, maybe one kind of approach is sort of more descriptively relevant. So we want to kind of taxonomize and understand these kinds of emergent social practices and practitioners in some way understand themselves and invoke this kind of language. But I guess I was wondering, does it make a normative difference in your view whether something is civil disobedience or just some other kind of non-compliance?
Yeah, so I think even if it is true, and I'm not entirely sure that it is, that in the end it doesn't make a normative difference, because what we look at are just the individual normative features of the act in question, and the categorization is secondary. And there's no kind of clustering effect that somehow adds normative value to bringing these together in specific forms. Even if that were true, I think there are at least sort of three reasons for why it might be relevant. They're maybe not, you know, purely philosophical. So one would be, philosophical, just saying, well, we have these categories, and they're philosophically interesting categories. They have been subject to a lot of debate. It's relevant for these debates whether they apply to the phenomenon or not. And we should revise these categories in light of certain new phenomena that require conceptual extension of revision. You know, that can be true for a lot of different philosophical categories, both in political philosophy as well as theoretical enterprises. A second, it's partly a pragmatic argument, I would say. I mean, there is just this extensive body of literature on civil disobedience, and it helps to use the arguments that have been made in that context to think about other cases rather than always from scratch in a way say, well, what are the individual features in this case, and how should we evaluate what's going on here? So, there's a kind of pragmatic value to clustering or categorization that, you know, by the principle be reducible to the individual components, but still for pragmatic reasons it's useful. And thirdly, and you know, philosophy being a kind of collaborative enterprise relies on these links in ways. And thirdly, as I pointed out before, I think there's a very strong political reason. Simply because these categories carry normative weight, whether we find it philosophically convincing or not, in the public debate, in courts, in political lawmaking, etc. So that would be, in writing about these topics, at least for me, part of the motivation is practical, not political. Although it's not only that, there's also a philosophical interest in it. So I think it does make a normative difference. Whether it's a normative difference that, you know, is only political or only pragmatic and also philosophical, I'm a bit less sure about.
You don't have to be certain. to leave something for your next visit. So please join me in thanking